Homelessness is an issue that has been incrementally creeping into the business community all over the Mid-Willamette Valley and up in Portland, predominantly more in Portland, perhaps. Transients are becoming more aggressive. Young transients are homeless. Many of the older homeless have mental health issues. How do we address all of these issues, helping the people, but yet still not impacting business? And Representative Gelser, please.
Homelessness is a very complex issue. There are a lot of reasons why people are homeless. I recently went and spent some time in community outreach where I met a number of families who were really struggling in this economy, people where both parents had been full-time workers and lost their jobs in this economy, or were working at those minimum wage jobs and were unable to find housing that they could afford and also afford food to support their families. Many of the individuals who are struggling with homelessness are people that have unaddressed mental health and substance abuse issues. This is an area where the state has really failed to invest. And if we did invest, we would save so much money over time after we made those initial investments. Mental health is extremely difficult to treat when you let it go to a point of crisis. It becomes expensive, people get hurt. It's important to remember a person that is mentally ill is much more likely to be the victim of a crime than to hurt someone else, and they are very likely to not be able to care for themselves. We can do a better job of identifying early onset mental illness. I've actually introduced legislation to do this. We know that most mental illness manifests itself in the adolescent years. We've introduced legislation that would allow students to participate in mental health screenings in middle and high schools. We know that without access to treatment early on, medication, counseling, psychotherapy, individuals will not be able to learn to manage and live successfully with their mental illness, which they can. I introduced legislation this last February that will update our youth suicide prevention plan for the first time in decades, but it also is going to allow us to go and look at the barriers to access to mental health services. And that really impacts a number of the youth that are out on our streets today. We have a lot of work to do, and we all pay the price when we let people suffer. We all pay the price when we don't address mental health and people turn to substance abuse as a self-medication. We have to find a way to invest in these things, and that is the single biggest thing that we can do to reduce the incidence of homelessness.
Well, this is a difficult problem. We did pass mental health budgeting to the counties in the short session of 2013, so we are working on funding those county services. I believe that one of the problems is when they closed the state hospital and they put people down in the communities, there wasn't enough resources there to take care of those people. Most of the people that are on the street have substance abuse problems. They're either alcoholics or drug users. So you really need to be trained to deal with those people. Our prisons now are becoming the new asylums because 30% of the prisoners in Oregon prisons have mental health issues. So you can see they've gone from the state hospital to the street, to being arrested, to prison. That's not a good thing for our community. Well, what do we do? I personally donate, my family donates to the shelters, the private shelters. I give to the Salem Mission because it's really interesting. They're very good at dealing with people with substance abuse. You have to be sober to go in there, so that's the first step. They help them get their GED. They help them with job skills. When I come over the bridge on 20 into Salem to go to work, there's guys standing there in their parking lot, and they're day laborers, and they're all cleaned up, ready to go to work, and people pick them up on the corner there because people trust that organization that those people are ready to work. So I think that's one thing we should partner with the private sector and come up with some solutions for these people. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Close. Well, it's just after 1, and now we're going to move forward to 2 minutes closing remarks from each candidate, and then each candidate has also graciously agreed to stay afterwards. If anyone has any questions, they'll be more than willing to respond to them. And so, Representative Gelser will be going first.
Thank you. Thank you all again for coming today and for submitting all of the interesting questions. I did want to make one clarification. We have not closed the state hospital. We actually have a state hospital in Salem. I was visiting there recently. The U.S. Department of Justice has told us we need to do a better job of moving people out of there faster, and we're opening a second state hospital in Junction City. Our investment in community-based mental health support is really critical. It's more cost-effective and it's more humane, and the U.S. Department of Justice is going to put a huge federal order on us if we don't do a better job of serving people in the community. I hope, as I said in the beginning, that when you get your ballot and you look at the choices that you have, that you will mark the ballot next to my name, Sarah Gelser. I want to serve as your state senator so that I can continue working hard for this community, so that I can continue working on unique and creative public policy solutions that actually make a difference for the people of Oregon. I believe that our state is a stronger, safer place. It has a better education system. Our public safety is stronger because you have given me the opportunity to go and serve you. With your vote, you will give me the chance to continue to do that for the next 4 years as your state senator. As your state senator, I will prioritize addressing climate change. I will stand firmly for a woman's right to choose, for access to emergency contraception and contraception as a preventive measure as well. I will stand for the equal rights of all people, including the right for people to choose who it is that they want to marry. I will continue working to tighten up our state's tax system, to make sure that our tax expenditures are prioritized appropriately and we are able to invest to lower our class sizes, to lower costs for students attempting to go to university, and that we can create an economy that works for everyone, including an increase in the minimum wage, equal pay for equal work, and of course, a statewide paid sick leave policy. This is why I am endorsed by the working people of the state of Oregon. They know that in this race, I am the candidate that will go to Salem and fight for them every day and deliver the economy that they're counting on to be able to help their children achieve their own dreams. Thank you again for coming, and I look forward to staying to answer as many questions as you might have, and I will also be at the League of Women Voters Town Hall Forum next week. Thank you.
Well, my friends, the Senate is about leadership, and we try very hard to, in the Senate, to watch what the House does and what comes to us. We're the last stop, and so we try to make sure that things are written correctly. Try to look and see down the road what the outcome is going to be if we take these actions. I take that very seriously. As your senator these past 2 years, I strive to discuss and delve into the problems that we face, and we do have problems, and come up with solutions that are simple and can be implemented easily. My banner bill in 2013 was a human trafficking bill that I did with Senator Betsy Johnson, a Democrat. It's a bipartisan bill. And Oregon was one of just 5 states that didn't have the felony on the first offense of purchasing sex from a minor. So what was happening on the weekends is people were flying into our airport in Portland, and they were picking up our Oregon children, and the Portland police testified and showed how many online are actually advertised. We just had an arrest in Albany with this bill where someone who did that was arrested under this new act. I'm going to try to strengthen that in the future. I also had a bill to give grants to counties for public-private partnerships that hire and train young workers. It passed the Senate, did not pass the House, but that was the work I was doing as a job developer. And I'm going to keep working on that. I did pass a bill to allow freshmen and sophomores access to advanced placement because it was just seniors and juniors. And that helps keep tuition down. That bill passed. They can now take advanced placement classes. And I would like to, in the future, also add vocational classes to that, that they can have access to advanced placement vocational classes. I've always supported education as a teacher. I did vote no on the first education budget we had in 2013 because I thought it was too low, and many of us did. The budget that I advocated was $150 million more than the one that passed, and my opponent voted for it. I'm ready to invest in the future of Oregon. I'm offering you my experience, my expertise, my energy. Together, I think, with all of us working together, we can get Oregon moving forward, the things we've talked about today. So let's go forward, let's work, let's invent, let's teach others, and let's prosper. Betsy Close, I ask you for your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, there are just so many people to thank today that there's one person I want to thank that this